We've got about 30 seconds until we choose it. I'm gonna go ahead into my app, open it up, and right there is my join virtual queue because I have a park pass already. And I've got about 10 seconds. Join virtual queue. Done. And I'm in just like that. We're already done with our virtual queue. So we can go ahead and take it to the next level, select our Genie Plus service. I'm going to skip that for now. But let's go ahead and creating my day. Our estimated check-in. So in there it says on our virtual queue, the Genie is telling me that it is at, we are in group number 20, and my party is Kelsey and I. And our estimated wait is 275 minutes. The park doesn't open until 10, so that's why it is so long. And all we have to do is report back in 275 minutes. Or here it says our estimated time is 11:40 is our estimated time. So what we'll probably do is have some Remy's Ratatouille adventure and then maybe some crepes.
Good morning. We are headed to Epcot today to experience a bunch of new stuff. We got a boarding group for Remy's Ratatouille Adventure. We got like group 20, right? Mm-hmm. Good job, babe. Good job. And then we're gonna check out the Creperie, hopefully. Watch Harmonious and check out all the new stuff that Epcot has to offer right now, including like the Fab 50 statues and all that fun stuff. So I'm also wearing my new Mandalorian sweatshirt. It's my favorite thing in the world, and we're super excited. So let's go. We are through the gates.
So they do have early park entry. It's 30 minutes early for resort guests only. We are not resort guests, at least at Disney this trip. So we have to wait until 10 like the rest of us. But it is 9:26 and they went ahead and opened the gates for us. So it does look like they're holding some people up. So we'll see what's going on with that. So they're just letting the early park people around and they are pushing us up and holding us behind a rope just until they're ready to let us in. So they're starting to relieve some of that congestion to let people in the park.
First time seeing all of the France expansion. I'm so excited.
Thank you. alcoholic and non-alcoholic drinks. You've got soup and salad. You also have the pre-fee menu, which is $33. And for that, for $33, you get either a soup, a salad, a savory crepe, and your choice of a dessert crepe. And then you get also either a hard cider, cider or juice. Here are the ciders. $33 for all those things. It's a pretty good deal. And so we each do that, and then we're just not going to eat dinner until later this evening. So this will be our lunch and snack and second snack for the day. The first part of our pre-fee meal has arrived. Barrett got the salad. I got the soup of the day, which is potato and leek soup.
The vinaigrette's good. It's like a mustardy kind of vinaigrette. There's one.
So it's super creamy, has a really good flavor, really good texture. A decent portion size since we're going to have two crepes on top of this, so 10 out of 10.
Made it down to the Japan Pavilion and the World Showcase. Wait times are nuts today.
They're like pre-pandemic times. I'm thinking there might be some merit to the folks who are saying that Lightning Lane could be part of the problem with the wait times. I mean, crowd levels are pretty high.
There are no available park passes for today.
And it looks, I mean, in some ways it's kind of refreshing. Having so many folks here again, but yeah. The wait times definitely are gross.
Yeah.
And we're trying to navigate that as we go.
Yeah.
Creperie?
Yes. We just came from our lunch at La Creperie de Paris, and we both had the pre-fix menu. Mm-hmm. So I had the leek and potato soup, which was delicious. Garrett had a salad. And then I had the classic crepe, which was ham and egg and Swiss cheese. What did you have?
And I did the savon, I believe. Anyway, it's basically ham and cheese, but it's roquette cheese, and it's a ham that's in there with caramelized onions. So it was pretty great with that. And then we went and did the sweet stuff. I did the pomme, which is an apple with caramel. And it was just absolutely delightful, and Kelsey did.
I don't remember how to pronounce what I had, but it was a hazelnut spread.
I think that's what it's called.
No, it was called something different. It started with a G. Really good, though. It was all really good. And then it also came with hard cider.
So they had a brut, which is a dry, and then they had a semi-sweet, a sweet, and a really, really sweet. So Kelsey had the sweet, which was the dieu.
Yeah,
I had the...
You had the, like... Not dry.
I had the
one.
Yeah, I had the medium one, the semi-sweet one, which was good. It was kind of like regular American hard ciders that we get. Sorry, I got to switch hands. It was kind of like the regular American hard ciders that you get at home.
Mm-hmm.
But the cool thing about the creperie is that the crepes are all, and galettes is what the savory ones are called, are all imported. The flour is imported from Brittany, France. So it's all buckwheat flour. So buckwheat is a little bit different taste. It's not like your typical white flour, but it's a very good taste.
I'm typically not a fan of buckwheat.
But I am here.
But here, those crepes were delicious. So I highly recommend, even if you are not a fan of buckwheat, to try them, because they're really good. And the $33 for all of that was a good deal.
It was okay, yeah. So total, everything came to, I think, $70 with tax and everything. And then, which would leave you about a $14 tip for the whole thing. And we're full. I think we're both comfortably full.
Yeah.
It was still probably too much food, but, you know, we're... In some ways, we're still pre-pandemic eating, so...
Yeah, it's fine.
Pre-pandemic.
It's fine.
Mid-pandemic eating. All right, now what?
It's fine. We're going to keep going.
Mitsukoshi.
Let's keep going.
So something a lot of folks don't know is that Mitsukoshi is an actual Japanese store, and it carries all kinds of things from groceries to just everyday things that you would need. And on the wall here, as soon as you come into Mitsukoshi, they have a story about the very first store of the Mitsukoshi organization in 1673. And the very first department store in Japan. Think of what it looks like today. And these are all over Japan. And again, you can get everything from grab-and-go food to any kind of staple that you would want and anything that you could desire. Matured. The rush is good?
Yeah, rush is pretty good. Russia and Moldova are winners. They're winners.
Beverly. Beverly is a winner.
Beverly's not a winner. That's horrible. No.
The Madagascar is the tropical fruit blend is good. And this is more like a sweeter, but it's like it's merengue. It's just tropical fruit. And now we're gonna try Joy. It's still, it's from Korea. It's apple and lychee. And lychee is, tastes fine too. I like it too. I like all of them so far.
We try Russia?
Yeah, this is the cucumber Sprite.
Yeah.
Okay. Might need some Beverly to cleanse my palate.
Oh gosh, ew. Good.
It tastes like cucumber.
It does, but it's good.
Royal watermelon is a sparkling beverage with refreshingly sour watermelon flavor, exclusively in the Philippines.
Ooh. Ooh. Yeah, I like that one. That's my fave. That's my fave so far.
It's like sour Hawaiian punch.
Mm-hmm.
With like, it's sparkling.
Red and the light bulb.
This is one. China.
People are saying China's awful.
I think it's pronounced Suan Mei Tang. A sour plum tea, traditional Chinese beverage that has existed for over 1,000 years, so it's probably pretty good.
We'll see.
Smart sour plum has savory, sweet, and tart flavor that is considered by many to be the ultimate sparkling thirst quencher on a hot day. Smells pretty awful.
That smell does not spark joy. That smell does not spark joy.
Right, right. You gotta taste it. You gotta do it.
Tastes like barbecue sauce.
It smells a little barbecue-y.
Yeah. Smells like it. And tastes like it.
It's carbonated barbecue sauce. So we just got out of Club Cool, and we've tried all the flavors, some of them twice. All of the flavors in Club Cool are brand new, with the exception of Beverly. Beverly's is one that they kept.
Just as bad as I remember it.
It was really good. I thought it was good. So we went down the line, and then eventually Kelsey stopped waiting on me, so she started at the other end. But I think the issue was China. That was the bad one.
Oh.
Yeah, the Chinese offering was bad.
It smelled like barbecue sauce.
Yeah, it kind of...
like barbecue sauce.
It tasted like watery, carbonated barbecue sauce. And I'm not a big fan of watery, carbonated barbecue sauce anyway, so I thought maybe it shouldn't do that.
Yeah.
But I also think that that should be the last flavor that you try, because I liked all the flavors I tried before that, at least to some degree. But after I had that China,
it messes with you.
It messed with your palate.
Yeah.
I didn't even like Beverly anymore. No, the others tasted like cough syrup. The fruity ones tasted like cough syrup after that.
After China, yeah. The winner for me was the Philippines. That was so good. I love that one.
The Philippines?
Yes.
Was that the...
I don't remember exactly what it was called.
Oh, the watermelon one. It was the watermelon one from the Philippines.
It was so
that was
good.
Really good. I thought the lychee apple from Korea was good.
Yeah, that one was pretty good. I had that one after China.
Yeah.
So it wasn't as good as it probably could have been.
The Russia cucumber Sprite was interesting. It tasted just like cucumbers, but and then that last one, the Viva from Moldova, was good. It just
it was good.
Felt a little flat. My favorite was probably the Country Club from Madagascar.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
That one tasted like cough syrup to me too, but of course I tried that after China as well, so I don't know.
Yeah, they had two tropical fruit flavored ones, and the Madagascar one had more depth to it, I thought. And so that's something that I would order out for sure.
Yeah, the Philippines one is one that I would order for sure.
The Club Cool also has a bunch of Coca-Cola merchandise as well. And the floors aren't sticky.
Yeah,
they're kind of limiting everybody in there, and everybody, each party gets their own machine that has all of the flavors on it. So it's really, really cool. It's really laid out well. It's super easy to get around. Of course, we did Creations right beside it. It's right beside the new Creation shop. So it's a hop, just hop right over after you're done shopping or before. And so now I think we're going back to World Showcase.
Yeah, let's see what we get into.
So this is one of my favorite holiday trees because it's like my favorite part. And it's because they have bulbs from every country, well, that feature every country's flag, and then ornaments that say Happy Holidays and all the various languages around World Showcase. And I think it's just great. And then the tree topper angel is holding a globe, world peace, all good things. Hi, Kelsey.
voices calling out in search of one another, we find each other in song.
Oh! Thank you.
here. We are at the Boardwalk Resort, which is...
You can talk regularly.
I feel like we're doing something we shouldn't be doing. We are at the Boardwalk Resort. We walked over to the Boardwalk to avoid the mass exodus from Epcot.
To get ice cream.
To get ice cream, because Boardwalk's open late. So we went to Boardwalk Ice Cream, got some delightful ice cream. So then we were like, we gotta get to the lobby so we can catch an Uber back to our, you know, Kamana Bay. And I didn't think we could get in without a key, but
the door was open.
The door was unlocked.
Explore.
Now we're in. So we're gonna go. Come on.
Not the real one, the one at Epcot.
Over there on the bank is Mr. Olaf.
He's got a little present.
He's on a sled.
Uh-huh.
Wonderful presents for Samantha. Samantha? I don't know Samantha.